And then there's other problems with meat, you know.
What is it, the amine, the hypocyclic amines? What do they call it again?
Well, those are nitrosamines.
Okay, yeah. That's what you're talking
about,
right?
And then
there's
also polycyclic amines and polycyclic carbonyls, which happen
with heat. What about
the
heme and the sort of implications for promoting IGF-1? Like, there are other aspects of it as well.
So IGF-1 has nothing to do with heme, but...
those are two different things.
Yeah, so I'll explain. So one of the things, so there have been studies linking protein and meat consumption to cancer incidence. And there was a really well-done study published last year by Walter Longo's lab at UCLA. And he's been doing a lot of research in this area. He's a very good scientist. He does studies on humans that are correlative, so epidemiological mm-hmm. studies, but he backs them up with mouse data, and then he goes into like cultured cells and he teases apart all the mechanisms, you know, so he doesn't just make an association. He first makes the observation, he finds the correlation, and then he goes into the mouse model and he, you know, gives them a certain diet, he controls everything, uh-huh. and then he goes and dives even further into all the biochemical and molecular pathways in different cultured cells. So, you know, which is why he always ends up getting like a really high impact scientific publication, like uh-huh. Nature or Science. So he's always publishing in those really high impact journals. So a study that he published last year was, it was looking at, I forgot the time frame, but it was, you know, people that were eating, you know, protein, meat, and it looked at the, you know, how much they were eating and correlated it to their all-cause mortality. So they're looking at cancer, or they're looking at different cardiovascular mm-hmm. related diseases. I'm not sure they were looking at neurodegenerative disease, but they were definitely looking at those two. And they found that people that eat more meat had a higher all-cause mortality. They had mm-hmm. more cardiovascular disease, they had more cancer. That was the real main thing. They had more mm-hmm. cancer. But it was a certain, it was people that were older, but not too old. So once mm-hmm. you got to a certain age, like above, I don't remember exactly, 55 or something like that, the opposite was true. So protein became more important. Mm. Protein intake was inversely correlated with mortality. So the higher the protein intake, the lower the all-cause mortality. And okay. I think that has a lot to do with frailty. You know, as you get older, you fall down and break a bone. You know, muscle mass is also a very important indicator of mm-hmm. all-cause mortality. Not everyone that's vegan is training like you mm-hmm. is, you know, very aware of making sure they're maintaining the muscle mass and staying physically fit. So protein does become important as you're getting older, because you don't want to break a hip and then takes you out, you know. Mm-hmm. So, but what was interesting about this study is that they went into animal models and they gave animal models cancer. So they basically injected them with some tumor cells, various types of cancer, and then they gave them either high protein, low protein diet, and they looked at the tumor growth. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't like feeding mice protein initiated cancer, which is a very different mm-hmm. Point. So there's something that initiates cancer, and there's something then that can then
promote
it to grow.
Right.
And so IGF-1 is a growth factor. It's important for muscle growth. It's important for, you know, neuronal cell survival. It's important to make new neurons. I mean, you want IGF-1. Mm-hmm. You want it to repair damaged muscle. You want it to make new neurons. And when you're a kid, you want it to grow. however, as you become older and you have accumulated a lifetime of damaged cells, let's say you're eating a diet that's high in refined carbohydrates and sugars, damaged cells, you're eating a bunch of processed meat, mm-hmm. things that are causing DNA damage. You don't want damaged cells to keep growing. You want them to die.
Right, so the IGF-1 is really like throwing gasoline on the fire.
Exactly,
right?
Yeah. Exactly. So. Yeah. It's all about the context. And so these mice that were given a high protein diet, the tumors grew faster. Duh. Their mm-hmm. IGF-1 was going up. IGF-1 is a major promoter of cancer. It can allow cancer cells to grow and thrive. And when we have a damaged cell, our body knows it. And our body goes, oh, wow, this is not good. If I don't kill this guy, it's going to potentially become cancer. So it kills it. Mm-hmm. But you know what IGF-1 does? IGF-1 comes over and it's like, oh, no, don't die. No, we're cool. We're cool. Right. So it like overrides that whole inherent pathway that we have, you know, in our bodies that are protective against getting cancer. So IGF-1 can be very bad, but it all depends on the person. So if you have someone that is, you know, very health conscientious, that's an omnivore, people that are not eating processed foods, refined carbohydrates, not eating a bunch of processed meats. They're, you know, they're eating their healthy meats, And they're getting a lot of plants, a lot of, you know, micronutrients, they're exercising, they're doing all the right things to minimize the amount of damage, to minimize their inflammation, mm-hmm. they're getting enough fiber, all that stuff. You know, IGF-1's not as much of a problem for those people as it is for the person who is eating meat and all the other bullshit.
Right. Interesting.
You know, so I think that's something very important to keep in mind is the context. So when you've got these big headlines that come out, they say, eating meat causes cancer. Well, not exactly.
Right.
You know.
Well, I think it's I think it's hard to talk about this study and the press release. I mean, the internet exploded yesterday, right?
Right.
Like with this news. And what's just as amazing as these scientific results in these studies is the conversation that's swirling around it, right? And the sort of participation of journalism in that dialogue. So we're in this clickbait culture. So there's this sort of, you know, commercial drive to create these sensational headlines that don't necessarily accurately reflect what the study actually says. I feel like you're like one of the few people who's actually qualified to pontificate on what these studies mean, actually, but most people aren't. You know, they're just going to read the headline and they're going to draw their conclusion and they're not going to really get into it. And it's been interesting to watch kind of over the last 24 hours how, you know, these different camps are sort of, you know, solidifying their positions. So you have the like bacon loving,
right,
low carb people who are, you know, basically throwing the predictable, you know, barbs out there about how it's correlative and like blah, blah, blah. It doesn't mean anything. And which is sort of an argument you can make about any kind, most nutritional studies, because that's the very nature of how they're done, right? And then I saw a funny headline on like a parody site. So something like in the wake of the WHO press release, vegans 250% more likely to be, you know, snarky or something like that. You know what I mean? So it's like both sides can participate in this dance that's going on around it. And of course, you know, it's not like eat a piece of bacon and you get cancer. It's certainly not that. But I think also to just dismiss it out of hand and say this is meaningless and doesn't require us to even look at it and is lacking merit is ridiculous as well. I mean, I think that this was a consortium of scientists that spanned not just the WHO, but these other organizations over 10 countries. I think they looked at 800 studies. And, you know, that dealt with many populations of people. And of course, you know, you can't control, they're human beings. You can't control for every variable. It's impossible to do so. And I think they even did try to control for certain cofactors, and that actually made the statistics less dramatic in doing so. And
right,
they still were able to come up with these correlative figures of, you know, what was it, 18% for every 50 grams of processed meat, more likely for, was it colon cancer, colorectal mm-hmm. cancer, 17% per 100 gram of red meat for a couple other, pancreatic cancer, I think a couple other ones, whatever. So you can parse that out and draw from it what you will. But I think at the end of the day, like what I take away from it is saying, yeah, well, this is something that there's clearly some risks associated with this. And we need to like, you know, take a look at that.